Many a times when we ask our questions to do with this religion, we don't know where our questions are coming from. And if we were to know where the questions were coming from, it would completely change our perspectives on what we are asking and how we receive the answers to those questions. You see, our religion, Islam, which we claim to be the perfect religion and the guide for mankind, is split wholly into two. Aqaid and Fiqh, which is the belief system, theology, and law, the Sharia, the do's and the don'ts, what's haram, what's halal. But before what's haram and what's halal is the Aqaid, the theology, the belief system. In fact, the belief system is called Al-Fiqh Al-Akbar, whereas Fiqh and law is called Al-Fiqh Al-Asghar. Tonight, I want to talk a little bit on Al-Fiqh Al-Akbar, so the belief system. And tomorrow we'll go into Al-Fiqh Al-Asghar, the law behind the belief system. Now, with our Aqaid in Islam, it's different to the law in that with law, we have to follow a scholar. We follow a marja for the do's and don'ts. With Aqaid though, you don't follow anyone. With Aqaid, it's actually obligatory upon you to find out the truth for yourself. Every single mukallaf, every single one of us here has to find out the truth for ourselves. Now, another differentiating factor between Aqaid and Fiqh is that without Aqaid being our foundation, if it was shaky, then when it comes to Fiqh, we're also shaky, since the Aqaid comes before it. So when we're told something is halal and haram and we ask why, and we don't understand why, we might not take it into consideration anymore. But when your foundation is steady and it's firm, when you understand why first, then when it comes to the do's and don'ts, you will accept it. But unfortunately, I think many of us were brought up with more of what's haram, what's halal, and maybe we see things more in a fearful way. You know, when you're young and they tell you, Allah bikhna'ak if you do this, you know, and you just get scared, like a rope is going to come to you at night. Right? And that's not really the way it works. Allah bikhna'ak hada. First of all, we should build our foundation before we come to the laws, to the do's and don'ts. They're very important, but foundation will explain everything to us. Now, when we ask why, for example, do I have to wash my feet or wipe my feet after washing my arms in wudu? Why? I don't know. We don't know. That comes in the sources. It tells us you do wudu this way. But why is Maghrib 3 rak'ahs and Aisha 4 rak'ahs? Why? We don't know. That's what came and the Sharia. We will accept that if we know that the source it came from is true. Proving the source is in aqaid. So we start with aqaid and then we go to the law. Tomorrow we're going to focus on the law, but right now we're going to aqaid. Now in Islam, you have usul al-deen, the principles of the religion, which are three. And we have this in common with the other sects in this religion, which is tawheed, nubuwah, and ma'ad. Tawheed being the oneness of God, nubuwah being prophethood, and ma'ad being the return after everyone dies in judgment day, we will return to Allah. But usul al-madhab within the Ja'fari madhab, with us, we have two more principles that we add on that differentiates us from our brothers of the other sects. We have tawheed, adala, which is the justice of God, nubuwah, imama, and then ma'ad. Now tonight I'm going to touch on a few of them. You can't do all of this in like an hour, unfortunately. But we'll touch on a few of them, and then tomorrow inshallah we'll go into al-fiqh al-asghar. Salah al-Muhammad wa al-Muhammad. God. God. When I say that word, I'm treading on all kinds of landmines. Now, thankfully, hopefully we're brought up in safe and peaceful environments, and that word doesn't have negative connotations to us. But in the wider world, when you say God, you're going everywhere, all over the place. There. Thank you. You have the people who are winning music awards that thank God, and then you have people cursing God for the evil in the world, and why were there earthquakes, and why were there volcanoes, and then you have someone loving God so much that he dances to God, and then it's all over the place. Now, when I was a young child, we used to have something called a Walkman. Unfortunately, the little guys here, I don't think you would know about it too much. It was like, it plays tapes, right? And you have to fast forward and rewind everything manually. And if you want to record something, you have to record on the radio and tell all your brothers and sisters not to talk so that you can record it, right? And then you go outside and you have your little Walkman, you're happy. See, some people don't know what a Walkman is right now. The reason I'm bringing this up is because the Walkman is a relic. And people claim that God, in this day and age, is like the Walkman, a relic. And do we really need him in this age, in this time of evolution, in this state that we have reached as human beings? Do we need God? Or is he out of fashion now? Is the modern world not in need of God? And you get people with all kinds of crazy theories that try to tell you that God doesn't exist and why he doesn't exist. I actually met this brother in London recently. We were talking about God and we were debating on religion, and he says there is no religion, there is no God. I says, why? And he said, because you can't be sure of anything. Nothing is certain. And I said, what do you mean? He goes, we can't know anything. There's even if there's proof for something, I'm like, aren't I sitting in front of you right now? It was maybe. But maybe some chemicals are releasing in my brain that make me think that you're in front of me. Maybe you're not really in front of me. You know those guys who just want to slap them so they can feel the pain. But the pain may become chemicals as well. Right? So then he's telling me, you can't be sure about anything. So I asked him, are you sure about that? He said, no. I said, how can I talk to you? You're not sure by your own argument. He defeated himself. He said, nothing is certain. But he's not certain that nothing is certain. These kind of arguments are available everywhere, and they'll confuse you and take you around in cycles. But I'm going to touch on a few proofs, intellectual proofs, on why there must be a God. There must be. And the first one is called Dalil al-Imkan. It's the evidence of the possible and the necessary existent. And it can start with this microphone. Okay? Did this get here on its own? It couldn't have. Someone put it here. If I told anyone this just appeared, you'd call me crazy. Someone put it here because it's an effect of a cause. There are causes and there are effects, and that's how the whole world works. Nothing just happens. Things cause the other things. So then we look at ourselves as human beings and we ask ourselves, where did we come from? Or where does Earth come from? Where did life come from? And again, they'll tell you those crazy theories. Let's say, like, first of all, it came with a Big Bang. Okay, where did the Big Bang come from? It came from a bunch of energy and it all mixed up together and created life. Where did the energy come from? And they'll keep going. And the energy came from some dark matter. And where did the dark matter come from? It came from an atom. If you keep going and going and going, nothing actually happens. To give you an example, if all of us here want to go get into a race after the majlis, and I said, I'm not going to start the race until you start the race. But you're not going to start until you start. And you're not going to start until you start. The race doesn't actually start. You realize? If someone started the race, then someone must have started it. You have to go back to it. Or another example. Say you're at school and you want this letter signed by your teacher. You take the letter and you say, teacher, can you sign this for me? He says, sure, but first get permission from Mr. So-and-so. So you go to Mr. So-and-so and you ask them, can you sign this for me? And he says, yes, but go to Miss So-and-so. You go to Miss So-and-so and you ask, and you keep going and going and going. Does your letter ever get signed? It doesn't get signed. There has to be something to start the effects. There has to be an initial cause. This is where we come to something called wajib al-wujud, the necessary existent. The existent that is not reliant upon anything else. In itself, it is too wealthy and rich within its own self, its own life, to rely upon anything else. All of us here are possible existence. There was a time when we didn't exist, and then there's a time that we came to exist. The necessary existent has always existed. It must have, because it's the one that started everything. If you tell me what brought the necessary existent into being, I'll tell you, you're thinking within time and space. Necessary existent created time and space. He's not confined by it. The way we think as human beings is within time and space. It's above our minds to think out of that realm. The necessary existent, by the way, these big words existent, like, it doesn't matter, the meaning is clear. The necessary existent within itself is alive, not depending on any of us or any possible existent. Salawat Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Now, for us, we see that we are here. So there must have been a start point. The starting point was that necessary existence. This is an ironclad argument. Anyone who tries to come to you and talk to you about God and God not existing, just tell him, okay, cause and effect, where did we come from? And he'll keep going round and round. Another one. If I told you that you have person X and person Y, and person X is the most beautiful, the wealthiest, everything materialistic this person has, but person Y isn't very beautiful, is quite poor, but has excellent manners, is very loving. But person X has terrible manners, is very mean and rude, and swears a lot. But on the outside, very beautiful and everything is available. Who would you rather have as a friend or in your life? The one with no akhlaq or the one with akhlaq? Bearing in mind that this person isn't as beautiful as this person. It doesn't have as much material as this person. Everyone that I've asked so far, hopefully no one disagrees, is they would want the person with akhlaq in their life. Because we are inclined to goodness. Even if this person is the most beautiful, we can't handle someone in our life who's always being mean and rude and around us and has no manners around us. You'd want the one with manners, but why? If there was no God, what's good? Why even be good? They'll come to you and they'll say, I want to be good for the sake of good. What does that mean? Why isn't your good bad? What if your good is my bad and my bad is your good and my good is your bad? Who's to say? Why be good? And who decides what's good? Who decides? Is it like a 49%, 51% majority? Does that mean that 49% people are evil? If it's 70-30, are those 30% evil? Who said what's good? Does the UN say what's good? And they allow Saudi Arabia to bomb Yemen and do nothing about it? Who says? No, there's a higher power. Even the atheist wants to be good. There's a reason for that. He's inclined to good. He wants to be good. Now, our entire lives, we are searching for one thing. Each and every single one of us are going towards more. Always. You always have a new goal. You want to finish school, you want to get a new job, you want to go to university, you graduate, you want to get married, you have kids. You have kids, now you want to become the CEO. You're always going for more and more and more. You finish something, you achieve something, you complete something, then you want to go for more. Why? All of us here have this thing deep inside us, I believe, that even if we want to deny it, that one night comes every now and then where you spend it on your own and there's this deep down meaninglessness inside. And you try to fill that with everything around you. And you feel like, I have a good life. I have my mom and my dad. Inshallah, I have a spouse. Money, work. You try to fill it and fill it and fill it. But this hole is infinite and it's not being filled. And you feel lonely. And that's because your whole life you're working towards more. What you actually love is more. You love infinity. Your true love in life is infinity. It's the thing that never finishes. That's the thing you're always chasing in life. And the only way you're going to fill this infinite hole is if you fill it with infinity. And there's only one infinity out there. And that's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's only one infinity out there. Now if I told you, and try to get your head around this example, if I told you that you're hungry, but there's no such thing as food. Try to think of it for a second. You're hungry, but there's no such thing as food on the outside. Can that be? What am I hungry for? How do you know the feeling of hunger if there's no food? You're thirsty, but there's no water. So what are you thirsty for? You love infinity. How could there not be an infinity? Your love for infinity is a proof for itself. Your whole life you're working towards it. How can it not be there? As if saying, there's no water to the thirsty one. What are you thirsty for? Infinity is there because you love it. Your entire life you're going towards it. Yesterday we spoke about being born with a question. The question being why. And your whole life you're working towards the answer to that question. That's the journey of more. Your journey towards your true love, which is infinity. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الناس أنتم الفقراء إلى الله. O people, you are the poor ones to God. You are in poverty to God. An ancient scholar from a few hundred years ago, his name is Mulla Sadra. He has this proof, he says, he claims, and it's a big claim, that from this mere proof, he can prove God. And not just prove God, he proves how we connect to God. And he calls it al-faqr al-dhati. In that, when someone realizes the essence of their poverty inside, of how poor they are as a human being, that you have no control over your own existence, and this is how poor you are, this is your reality, once someone realizes that, they change. If we are the faqir, al-mutlaq, the one that doesn't even depend, doesn't even have his own power over his own existence, that depends everything on another existence, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the ghani, al-mutlaq. Mutlaq means an infinity. He's total ghina. We are total faqr. Total. In truth, you have nothing. Nothing. And he has everything. Now, with this proof, it does two things. Two openings. It has the opening of the mind, opening of the heart. The first opening of the mind is your belief. When you know that you are in need, you change and you begin to believe in that being. You believe that He's the creator, He's the divine. He is the owner of you, the designer. You believe all those things. It's like the story of an atheist that traveled to Europe for a conference, for an interfaith conference, where all people of different religions gathered, monotheists and atheists. And there were Jews and Christians and Muslims. And they were atheists. And on the plane, this man is debating with the Muslims, he's debating with the Christians, and he's trying to prove why there is no God. And they're debating with him, and then they get to the conference, and he begins to speak, he gives a speech, and everyone claps. And then on their way back on the plane starts to go through some turbulence. And as it's going down, and a man thinks he's going to die, he screams, "Oh my God, save me!" And the plane goes steady, and they ask him, "What happened? You screamed, 'Oh my God, save me, who's your God?'" When that man felt felt like he was going to die and he was so weak, and he realized his poverty, because we don't realize our poverty, so keyword realize here. Realized his poverty, he connected to him. It's like that story with Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, when he was speaking to the sailor, the atheist sailor, and he told him, "Has your ship ever been broken at sea?" And the sailor told him, "Yes." He goes, "When you were drowning and there was no one there to help you, when you thought that you were going to die and there was no help in sight, could you have some small hope that you would get away, that you would be saved?" He said, "Yes, that small hope," because that's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That small hope is God. That feeling when you realize you are so poor in your own existence that you have no power, that's when you realize that there's a ghani above you and that you are the faqir, and you connect to him through that. That's the opening of the mind. That's the opening of the mind. But you see, the mind and the heart, they have to work together. That's why it's so important that with these majalis, with all the information that's being given, it's almost useless if we don't open our hearts to it. You could say that the mind and the heart are like two men in the woods, and when the woods are burning, one of the men is blind, the other man has no legs, and they both can't get out because the blind man doesn't know where he's going and the man with no legs can't get up. They have to work together. The man with eyes tells him where to go and the man with legs takes him there. That's how the mind and the intellect and the heart work. So that was the opening of the intellect. We come to the opening of the mind. Imam Khomeini, he says that your entire life journey is nothing but a shibr. A shibr is a measurement this big. So one shibr, two shibr, three shibr. He said your whole entire life journey is a shibr. From your mind to your heart. That's it. This is your journey. 22 centimeters. The opening of the heart is different to the opening of the mind. You feel it. When you see that newborn baby and how it can't even hold up its own neck, and how it longs for its mother, and its mother is its entire life. The place where the baby receives its food, where it's cleansed, everything is the mother. If the mother disappears out of sight for a few seconds, the baby begins to cry. And I was recently at a friend's house who have a newborn baby, and I was looking at the baby, how much it's crying. It's crying its soul out when the mother is out of the room. And when the mother comes, it begins to stop crying. Imagine you had that relationship with God, subhanahu wa ta'ala, where you realized and you felt it, not just realized it with your mind, you felt it, how poor you are, just like the baby realizes. Now, the baby doesn't know that it's realizing this, but we do. When you feel, in truth, that everything that you receive isn't from your own hand. Just like the baby who cries until the mother returns, imagine if we were like that, would cry and cry until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we felt that he was far from us, we'd come closer to him. That's a high level to achieve. The level of the newborn baby is a high level to achieve. Unfortunately, a lot of us go backwards as we grow up. But imagine you were to achieve that type of relationship. And our religion helps us to realize our poverty, so we may connect to the ghani. But in connecting to the ghani, as a faqir, because you're so poor, you become everything. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is da'im al-fadli ala al-bariyya. He's always giving, he's never going to hold back. When you ask, why is Allah giving me? It's because you're not seeing everything that's around you. You're like the fish that's in the water. And when someone asks the fish, how's the water? And the fish just goes, what's water? Right? Because you're living in the ni'am, you're living in the blessings always. If you were to zoom out, you would realize all the blessings. You are this faqir. If you were to let go and admit that you are faqir in the dua, for example, the adab al-dua, when you bring your hand up like that as a beggar, as a poor person, why? They're showing you are this person of poverty, you have nothing, you are this abd. But if you go to, let's say example, the richest man alive, and if you're connected to him always, your pockets are empty, but his pockets are always full, and he's always going to give you. Why do you have to worry about? You have nothing to worry about. If you are to admit your position though, well, fasting, after 12 hours of fasting, how weak are we? You're coming at the end of the day, you can barely move. Imagine 3-4 days of that. without us breaking our fast. This is the insan. How poor the human being is. He doesn't really have anything. Doesn't have anything. So you come to Allah and you ask Him. The reason why you ask Him is to realize your own position too. You know, Nabi Musa alayhi salam, he was very shy to ask God for anything. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would tell him, why don't you ask me? And then Musa would say, Lord, you know what I want. You know what's inside me. You can give it to me if you want to give it to me. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya Musa, ask me even for the salt of your day. For the salt of your day, ask me for it. Very simple. It doesn't have to be complicated. He wants him to ask him. See, there's levels. There's someone who asks Allah. There's someone who is shy to ask Allah. But then someone who asks Allah because Allah wants them to ask him. So it's as easy as that. You just come for a small thing. If your shoe is ripped, just go, oh Allah, I want a new shoe. It's that simple. Make a relationship with him where it's very loving. Just like the baby who yearns for his mother. You're that baby. That totally dependent being. Develop a relationship with him like that. There's an analogy about a king who owns a vast kingdom, and a peasant asks the king, he asks him, if all the water in the world was barren and there was no more water except a small cup, what would you give for that small cup of water? And the king said, I would give half of my kingdom. It's half of the kingdom gone for a small cup. And he says, and if you had a disease that would not allow you to urinate, what would you do? So there's no way for that water to go. He said, I would give the other half of my kingdom to cure my disease. So the peasant tells him, what kind of kingdom is worth a small cup of water and a small cup of urine? Is that, that's the most a person in this world can achieve, a kingdom, a king. And in the end, at the end of the day, when he is so poor, for water and for health, it goes to nothing. For us to realize our poverty to Him. أنتم الفقراء إلى الله. صلى على محمد وآل محمد. ثانيا على حبيب الزهراء. إمام الصادق عليه السلام has a beautiful narration. He says, إِذَا تَجَلَّ ضِيَاءِ الْمَعْرِفَةِ فِي الْفُؤَادِ. If the light of ma'rifah was manifested in the heart, فَهَا جَارِيحُ الْمَحَبَّةِ. The winds of love are waved just like the ocean waves. وَإِذَا هَا جَارِيحُ الْمَحَبَّةِ اسْتَأْنَسَ فِي ذِلَالَ الْمَحْبُوبِ. And if that happens, then the person enjoys his time in the shadow of the beloved, in the shade of the beloved being God subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَآثَرَ الْمَحْبُوبَ عَمَّنْ سِوَاهِ. And he went away from anything aside from the beloved. وَبَاشَرَ أَوَامِرَهُ وَاجْتَنَبَ نَوَاهِيهِ. And he did all that the beloved ordered him to do, and he let go of all that the beloved forbade him to do. That's love. Then Imam Hussein alayhi salam comes in on Dua Arafah and he tells us what love is. And then he just changes everything that the scholars would teach us in Aqaid when we say from the effect to the cause. You know, at the beginning we're talking about going from the effect to the cause. Imam Hussein says, I don't want to go to the effect. Because the effect in itself means there's a veil between me and you, Lord. That effect, I don't want to go to it. The athar. I don't want to go to the athar. I want to go to you through you. Bika astadillu alayk. Through you, I prove you. كيف يستدلُ عليك من هو بوجوده مفتقر إليك. How can the one try to prove you who in his own existence is poor to you? I don't even have power over my own existence. I'm trying to prove you. He's showing how these people with audacity to say there is no God even. He's not going to any effect. He doesn't want to go to the mountains and the stars and the seas to find God. He wants to go to God through God. مَتَ غِبْتَ مَتَ بَعَدْتَ. When did you go far? When did you disappear for me to try to prove you? You didn't go far. You've always been there. I went far. I went far. عميت عين لا تراقى عليها رقيبا. Blind is the eye that does not see you watching over it. That's how Hosea now speaks to his Lord. Look at the language of love. And this beautiful, beautiful line. هو الذي أنزل المؤنس لأحبائك حيث أوحشتهم العوالم. You are the one who gives مؤانسه, that tranquility, that peace. حيث أوحشتهم العوالم, to your loved ones when the worlds leave him lonely. Not عالم. He didn't say عالم, to العوالم. All the worlds. When all the worlds left your loved one lonely, you gave him that مؤانسه, that peace and that tranquility. It's a language of love. This is the language of the Imams and the Prophets. Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he was searching for his Lord, and he was traveling the lands, and he would look to the skies and he would see the moon, and he says, لا أحب الآفلين. I don't like the ones who go absent and the moon goes down. He's looking for God. He thinks, is God the moon? He says, I don't like the ones who go absent. Usually we understand that as he's looking at the moon, is that God? It went down. So then he said, لا أحب الآفلين. علامة الطباطي says, no. He gives it a different twist. He says, Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam was walking. He looks to the moon. Do I love it? I don't love it. So it can't be good. Then he says, لَا يُحَبُّ الْأَفْرِينَ. Then the moon goes down. He started with love. You see the difference between the two? There's a very small difference. There's one waiting for the moon to go down, saying it's not good. Then there's one looking at the moon, realizing I don't love it. And then it goes down. His main incentive was love. Love. That's the relationship that we have to try to build with our Lord. One of mahabbah and love. Now, the Lord is there. And He gave us this intellect. And we're trying to prove Him through this intellect. He gave us an outer guide and an inner guide. The outer guide was the prophets and the imams. The inner guide is the intellect. He's giving us this to guide us towards our perfection and our happiness. That's why we're here, for perfection and for happiness. He wants to guide us to that through the intellect and through the prophets and the imams. Now, if we were to say it's just intellect, then it's very limited. Why? Because the intellect can tell you, yes, keeping people's rights and respecting their rights is a good thing. But it doesn't tell you what those rights are. It won't. It will tell you justice is good. But then where is justice here? Where's justice there? The intellect is limited. At the same time, the intellect can't tell you how to thank the Lord. It won't tell you you have to pray 5 times a day. It tells you I should thank someone for all this, but it can't tell you how. Also, just because the intellect realizes something is good and something is bad, doesn't mean that you have to stick to it. Okay, stealing is bad, but I'm really hungry. And it's a very shiny red apple. I'm going to take it. What's to stop me? The intellect can be taken by hawa, by the passions. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent something to help the intellect. The intellect is trying to guide us, but it's limited. So just like you invite your friend to come somewhere, to come to you, but you know he can't find his way on his own. You send someone to make sure he brings him. The intellect is the initial invitation. The prophet comes down and takes you towards your destination. The prophet is the outer guide. They work together to guide you towards where you have to go. All the prophets were sent down in this way. And the final prophet, who came with the perfect religion, which no religion must come after it, and no prophet comes after him, and no more revelation, this was the seal, claims that this religion is perfect. So we have to know exactly from this religion where we have to go and how to achieve happiness. But Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, please recite sallallahu alayhi But Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi was living in the time of revelation for 23 years. In that 23 years, he went through so much hardship and so much tension and so many wars. He was not able to give us everything we needed to know about this religion in 23 years. He wasn't. And if this religion is perfect, then how can I not know everything from the time of the Prophet? So the intellect tells us, and it dictates, there must be someone after the Prophet who can also answer everything perfectly and explain Islam perfectly. And that's why we have an imam who does not receive revelation like the Prophet, but he has all the knowledge within the religion like the Prophet. So he does not receive direct revelation, but he can still explain everything perfectly. If we were to have someone who we nominate, he will not be able to explain to us the religion in the perfect way that we believe it to be. So then, if we are to prove that Imam Ali alayhi salam is indeed the leader after the Prophet, then you prove the rest of the Imams after him. You have to prove that Imam Ali alayhi salam is that Imam. Imam Ali alayhi salam, he used to reject the idea that the Islam is not perfect. That it is perfect. So there must be someone perfect to tell us about it, to explain it. And he says that he would answer every single question that would come to him. That means he has knowledge of the religion perfectly. Perfectly. So then, if we are to explain and prove that the Imam is indeed the leader after the Prophet, many of us would go to the Day of Ghadir, where we believe that the Prophet nominated Imam Ali alayhi salam, or announced, he announced that he is the leader after me, and the Khalifa after me. But in fact, this happened decades beforehand, when Imam Ali alayhi salam was still a young boy. Before they went to Medina, when the Prophet was still in Mecca in the early times of the revelation, the ayah came down and it said, "A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, wanzir ashiratakal aqrabin." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking to the Prophet, he's telling him, warn the near folk of your tribe, or the nearest kin of your tribe, of Bani Hashim. What's the warning? So, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi comes, he gathers Bani Hashim. This is in the early days of Islam, when people weren't taking it that seriously even. And he gathers Bani Hashim, and he begins, before they went to Medina, and he begins to tell them, who will be the trustee and my brother and the Khalifa after me? And no one says anything except a young Imam Ali. And he stands up and he sits down. And the Prophet asks a second time. Imam Ali alayhi salam again stands up and sits down. The third time, and no one says anything. The Imam gets up, and then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells him, you are the trustee, the brother and the Khalifa after me. And this hadith is a Sunni and Shia hadith. It's not a Shi'i hadith. It's mainstream. You can check it. The announcement happened ages before Ghadir. It didn't happen on Ghadir. Ghadir was just the re-announcement. So what happened between Yawm al-Dar, the day of Dar, that's the day of the hadith when the ayah came down and they had the gathering, and Ghadir, what happened from here to there? What happened was the blossoming of Imam Ali alayhi salam as the second in command after the Prophet. And that doesn't even need an announcement. If you are to look at the mosque, and if I'm to tell you, the mosque is there, but then it's a mosque in itself, what is more worthy? Me telling you that's a mosque, or it being a mosque? It being a mosque is more clear than me telling you that's a mosque. Okay, so how was it in the time of the Prophet? Imam Ali was the second in command in the time. He didn't need someone to come and say he's second in command. It was very clear. He was the general. He was his secretary. He was his best friend. He married his daughter. He was raised by him. He would ask him, he was his political advisor. He would give him the biggest theme, the biggest problems, everything. Imam Ali al-Islam would be the one who would solve them. And everything they did, Imam Ali was right by his side. Even when they were in a war, Imam Ali al-Islam would only go a few meters before coming back to see if the Prophet was okay. He was so attached to him. When Imam Ali alayhi salam would come into the mosque, everyone, even those who didn't like him, would have to stand up. When the Rasul was sitting down and his knees began to hurt after sitting for so long, no one would dare to come and hold Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi and bring him up. Only Imam Ali alayhi salam would come and do that. Only he would come and bring him up and take him. He was so close to the Prophet, and it was very evident. It was very evident. There's this nice story that I like between them, where there was this girl, a daughter, a very powerful man from another tribe, and she gets taken by the Muslims, but the Prophet doesn't make her a servant woman. He keeps her in Medina, and he waits for her father to come so he may make her Muslim. He may make him Muslim. So then, before the father comes, the girl wants to talk to the Rasul, but she's nervous. Every time she wants to talk to him, she's nervous. So Imam Ali would come to him and be like, he was the secretary, he was the one who would intervene between the people and the Prophet. In everything. There's even this letter from Muawiyah, that he writes to Muhammad ibn Abu Bakr, the man that Imam Ali alayhis-salam raised. He writes in it, in the time of the Prophet, Ali was like the stars that no one could reach. Muawiyah is saying this. Imam Ali alayhis-salam's arch enemy is calling the Imam a star that no one could reach. And this is in the book of Siffin, a very old book, one of the oldest books, very early in the time of Islam. It's not known very well. Now, we don't have much time now, fortunately, but going from Imam alayhi salam, proving all the other Imams, because each one tells us who the next Imam will be. The last two Imams, Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam and Imam al-Askari alayhi salam, they made us prepared for what was to come. The Shia at that time went through a very difficult time. They couldn't access the Imams as easily as they wanted to. They made us prepared for the Zaman of Ghaiba, what we're going through right now. And now the Imam is in Ghaiba. So we say, what do we do now? Who do we listen to? Well, the Imam has a letter. He says, refer to those who narrate our traditions. They are my proof over you, and I am Allah's proof over them. Who are those that narrate the traditions? Now, if me and you want to go and dedicate our lives to studying Islam and finding out the truth behind Islam, then that's fine, that's dandy. But if we're not, and most of us aren't, and it's very difficult for us to do that, then we should follow a scholar who knows what he's talking about, who is a mujtahid and a marja. He tells us the do's and don'ts. Now today I wanted to develop the silsila, the kind of the link between what I want to talk about tomorrow, which is the fiqh al-askar that we spoke about in the beginning. The do's and don'ts, the haram and halal. This is the foundation of that. When you believe, okay, God, Prophet, Imam, now who do I follow? It's still a link to the Imam. Inshallah tomorrow, we'll go into fiqh al-askar. And thank you for having me tonight. Please recite salawat before we go into the majlis. صلى على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على محمد Imam al-Hussein is getting ready to leave Medina. The Imam's family are gathering their things. They will leave the home they grew up in. They will soon be heading towards Mecca before embarking on their journey to Karbala. Before they leave Medina, the Imam wants to say goodbye. He goes to the grave of his grandfather, Rasulullah. He lays down upon the grave. The narrations tell us the Imam ends up falling asleep. He sees the Prophet in his dream. Rasulullah grabs Imam al-Husayn and pulls him to his chest. He embraces him tightly. The Imam tells him, "Oh, Jaddi, look what your nation has done to me. I'm tired of this place. Take me with you." The Prophet says, "Ya Hussein, you still have work to do. You have to go back before we meet again." As the Imam is sleeping, he feels a soft hand go over his head. He looks up, he sees a woman in black clothes. He realizes it's Sayyida Zainab. He tells her, "You are wearing the clothes of our mother. I thought it was her." He turns towards the grave of his mother. He walks over to Sayyida Fatima's shrine and he sits down. He begins to speak to Sayyida Fatima. What does he say? "Speak to me. Speak to me. Mother, I'm by your side. One last time, I'll sit and cry. Tonight is goodbye. Ana al-Ihsan, ya al-Ihsan. Fatima, ana azizik, shufi hali. ردي الإجواء قلبي من صار يما رحتي أشوف الدار خالي I'm your Hussein mother of Hussein look at me and my state return my call As to you I fall before going to meet my fate. Speak to me, kallimini. Fatima, I'll miss you so. I'll be lonely without you with me. But mother, now I must go. But before I do, I promise you, even if my head is their price, don't be scared, I am aware, I'll protect Zainab with both my eyes. Before I do, I promise you, Even if my head is their prize, don't be scared. I am aware. I'll protect Zainab with both my eyes. Salaam Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.